Of the week, Aaron Boone. For the week of September 6th through the 12th, Aaron went 11 for 30. That's a 367 average, 3 home runs, 12 RBI, a 767 slugging percentage. Congratulations, Aaron, our AE Door Sales Real Red of the Week.
Trip and final homestand coming up this week. It's on to San Diego, the Reds' final trip there. You never know about the Padres, though.
Well, first, the time change, George. You got to get used to going out to the West Coast, obviously. And then the Padres, who've had some tremendous winning streaks so far this year. An unpredictable team, boy, but they can really get hot.
Tony Gwynn and company will host the Reds. Then, after 20 days with no day off, the Reds finally get a day off. Then the final homestand against the Cardinals with Fan Appreciation Day on Sunday. McGuire comes to town.
Well, the house will be rocking, that's for sure. But look for Jack McKeon to walk Mark McGuire, or at least pitch around him if he comes up in a situation where he can hurt the ball club and their chance of winning. So maybe the home crowd boos the home team. But if they win, hey, a bunch of us will be cheering.
Big key right here for this week is keep winning and try to stay in both races heading down to the final finish line. Back to you, Jeff.
Welcome to San Diego, where all of the members of the 3,000 Hit Club are honored this year, including the newest National League member, Tony Gwynn, who passed that honor in August in Montreal. Tonight, Gwynn goes for the Padres. Denny Nagel will try to shut him down and keep the Reds in the pennant chase on Fox Sports Net, Ohio. Welcome to Jack Murphy Field at Qualcomm Stadium as Fox Sports Net Ohio presents Cincinnati Reds baseball. Tonight, it's the Reds against Tony Gwynn and the San Diego Padres. Hi, hello, and welcome to San Diego, everybody. Along with the crafty left-hander Chris Welch, I'm George Grant. Simply put, Chris, 12 games less, the Reds have to plan to win every one of them.
Well, they got to plan to win every one, George, but they also have the attitude that really got them here. Play loose, have a little bit of fun, and it really rests on the veterans to come up and kind of keep these guys loose. You can't get too nervous right now or you'll never get it done.
When you play the Padres, you know you play Tony Gwynn, who's passed the 3,000 hit mark. Always trouble against the Reds at 330 career average, but when you take a look at our G pitching matchup, one of the toughest pitchers he says he's faced in his career is Denny Nagel.
That's because Denny Nagel's got such a good changeup, a good control over his changeup as well. Tony Gwynn's got great coverage of the strike zone. You've got to change speeds, and Nagel can do that. He's up against Buddy Carlisle, a former Reds farmhand, looking for his fifth start of the year. This guy's not going to overwhelm you with his stuff, but he's right around the plate. He's got a bulldog personality, and he may be very tough tonight. He's got that little extra something going.
Padres have played well at home, and they've played well of late. See if the Reds can come up with a W tonight, next on Fox Sports Net, Ohio. They're 1-2 of a six-game road trip to Pittsburgh and San Diego for three. Then it's home against the St. Louis Cardinals for four. And then they end the season on the road, 12 games remaining. And as we talked about in the open, you just got to keep the pressure on, keep the pedal to the metal, and try to come up with W's each and every night. Let's check the Mercury starting lineup for Jack McKeon and the Cincinnati Reds as they come to San Diego. This is McKeon's old stomping grounds, where he was the general manager here, president, and also ran the operation for the better part of 10 years. Pokey Reese will be your second baseman. He'll be in the leadoff spot for the Reds tonight. Pokey in the leadoff spot. Barry Larkin hits second. Larkin playing short. Sean Casey trying to inch up into the number two spot in the National League hitting, will hit in the three spot. Greg Vaughn, the former Padre, who had 50 home runs here last year and at 40 already this year, is your cleanup hitter. Dimitri Young, the switch hitter, plays right. Eddie Taubensy, over 300. He's your catcher. Michael Tucker in center field. Boone is at third, and Nagel is your pitcher. There's your lineup, 1-9, and here's the former Red, the right-hander for the Padres.
Well, he was a Red until he was traded over here just about a year and 2 weeks ago. Buddy Carlisle, the right-hander, traded in the Mark Kroon deal. Kroon came right to Cincinnati. Carlisle went down to Double-A for the Padres, and he toiled away in the minor leagues this year, 11-8 in Triple-A, and here he is in the big leagues making start number five.
Pokey Reese, a one hopper to Phil Nevin, the third baseman, across the infield, and quickly there's one away. Here are the rest of those figures on Buddy Carlisle. This is his major league tally board, 21 innings, 20 hits, 11 walks, and 15 strikeouts. When he's gotten in trouble since he came up, Chris, it's that walk total of 11 that's hurt him.
Well, he's not an overpowering type pitcher, so he can't really afford to put too many guys on base because he doesn't have the strikeout pitch, but he does have good control over all four of his pitches, a fastball, a curveball, a slider, and a changeup, and he's got that bulldog mentality that has really caused him to take a lot of notice as a minor league pitcher, winning 14 games back-to-back years for the Reds, being traded over to the Padres, winning 11 games for AAA this year. You kind of force yourself on an organization to take notice when you put numbers up like that.
Carlisle, born in Omaha, hometown of Bellevue, Nebraska.
And now playing here in San Diego, trying to earn his spurs as a Padre. Here's Larkin. That pitch is a little bit low to Barry. Three balls and no strikes to the Reds captain. Don't forget, for every Reds home run between now and the end of the year, each sponsor of the Reds United Way Home Run Derby will donate $100 to the local United Way. Today we salute Weltman, Weinberg, and Reese. Reds get a base runner. Barry marches down to first. Let's check the four defense for this Padres team that looks a whole lot different from when we were here last time. Phil Nevin has won the job at third. Gomez, after the double knee surgery, is back at short. Kilvio Varas, a switch hitter at second. Eric Owens, a former Red, is playing first tonight. Ben Davis, the young rookies, up from AA and AAA behind the plate. Former Red, Reggie Sanders in left, Ruben Rivera in center. And yes, future Hall of Famer Tony Gwynn is over and right. That's your Padres defensive alignment. They are 13th in the league in defense. They've committed 124 errors this year. By the way, as we get started on this one, we can tell you that the Pirates are home against the Houston Astros. Pittsburgh leading 7-4 on the strength of five runs early, but it's been a rain delay. They're still bottom of the third inning at Pittsburgh. Lengthy rain delay for Larry Durker and the Astros at Pittsburgh against Gene Lamont and the Pirates. Will keep you updated on that one. In the standings as we start play today, the Reds 3.5 games back of Houston in the Central Division. Larkin inches off the bag at first, not going anywhere. Casey bounces it to second. Varas will shovel to Gomez. The throw is high and he's safe. So the Reds will get a second life and would look like a tailor-made 4-6-3 double play. Barry Larkin spoils Gomez's concentration at second, and the result, safe at first.
Well, you get an insight right here as to one of the reasons why the Padres are not the contenders they were last year. Easy double play ball right there. That was DP lane. Should have been, especially with Sean Casey running, but the throw by the shortstop Gomez, a little bit high. Eric Owens, former Red, could not come down with it in time. So a fielder's choice, no error for Gomez, who already has 12 on the year.
Here's Greg Vaughn. He got a very nice ovation when he was announced in pregame warmups. Vaughn, of course, helped this club make it to the postseason last year with 50 home runs. This year, 40 home runs and 104 runs batted in for the Reds. While some players left as free agents from last year's club and were not warmly welcomed back this year, Vaughn, of course, was traded. When we came here back in May, he was given a standing ovation and another warm welcome tonight. He had a great couple of years here, Chris, after a rocky beginning when he came over from Milwaukee. Had to split the left field job with Ricky Henderson, was not happy with it, finally won it outright, and he was the power source in a very impressive lineup for the Padres as they went to the postseason last year. One ball, two strikes with Casey down at first. He's traded for that guy, Reggie Sanders, and Sanders has had a fine year for San Diego. In fact, Reggie is on the verge of signing an extension, a multi-year contract with the Padres. Fastball up high. Carlisle gets him. Strand a runner after the walk in the first to the bottom of one. Varas, the Hall for the month of September at 391. Reggie Sanders, who's had an outstanding year at the plate and against Nagel, he is red hot through his career with three home runs and over 400. Nevin's won the third base job, and he is the cleanup hitter. Eric Owens will play first. Ruben Rivera, who has struggled offensively this year, in center field. Ben Davis, the rookie catcher. Gomez is short, and Carlisle, the pitcher. And here's the Reds' left-hander, Denny Nagel.
Well, Denny Nagel's been called on to do a number of things this year. One, keeping the team loose after some losses. Obviously, that was a big part in the long plane flight from Pittsburgh to San Diego last night. But also to stop some losing streaks. And Denny Nagel's got to do it again tonight. He is on a roll, however, looking for his fifth consecutive win. And since coming back off the disabled list in July, he's been outstanding. 7-2 record overall, earned run average under four. He's exactly what you would think that the Reds had gotten when they traded for Denny Nagel. This is really Nagel in midseason form.
Danny Nagel against Kilvio Varas. Varas, the switch hitter, against Nagel in his career. He's had very little success, 167, only 4-for-24, and a home run. Kilvio, remember, had the shoulder surgery in the offseason. They thought he'd missed the first month, maybe two of the season, but he was back early in the year. Battled through that and has gotten his average back up to 279. He is arbitration eligible at the end of this year, and the rumblings continue that the Padres may have difficulty signing him, so
they may go from within, meaning Eric Owens or Damian Jackson as a possible second baseman next year if Bruce Bochy and Kevin Towers can't reach agreement with Veras for next year.
Well, consider this. Veras right now looking at something of a $15 million three-year contract. That's a $5 million player. So if you're a small market team like the San Diego Padres, that's where you have to draw the line on decision time.
Padres,
do you keep them or do you not?
They have some serious questions they need to answer. Veras pops it up to the right side. Casey, Reese giving chase. Pokey on the track, loves it. What great range from Pokey Reese. He snares it for the first out here in the bottom of one. Let's check the defense. Sponsored by Ford. Reese and Larkin, the double play combo. Boone and Casey at the corners. Taubensy behind the plate. Vaughn, Tucker, and Young. And here comes Tony Gwynn. Sitting on 3,053 hits in his career. That's tied for 18th with Rod Carew, a guy who he idolized throughout his early days in baseball. And for Tony, this has been a up and down year. An up and down year because of the injury. When he's been in there, he's hit fine. You saw the 14-game hitting streak, but the nagging calf injury that he suffered against the Reds. Center field, Tucker over. Got it. Whoa. Michael reaches up, snares it, and robs Gwynn of extra bases. And there's two away here in the first inning. So Michael Tucker gives chase. The Reds manager, Jack McKeon, of course, followed Tony Gwynn not only through his amateur career. He drafted him out of San Diego State, nurtured him through the Reds, through the Padres minor leagues, and then into the major leagues. And as the night progresses, we'll hear from Tony Gwynn and hear from Jack McKeon about the guy who's destined for the Hall of Fame. Here's Reggie Sanders in at 290. Chris, I guess you have to say it's a trade that helped both ball clubs, Sanders, Vaughn.
It certainly did. You know, the Reds obviously beneficiaries of getting Greg Vaughn over here. 40 home runs, over 100 RBI, and Reggie Sanders needed a new place to play. There was no question about that.
Wow, deep to left, going way back. If it stares fair, it's gone, and it is. Number 25 for Reggie Sanders and his fourth home run of his career against Denny Nagel. He's punished Nagel, hitting over 400 against him in Pittsburgh, Atlanta, and even though the uniforms changed for Nagel, the results have stayed the same for Reggie Sanders. No doubt about this one.
Reggie Sanders with 25 home runs on the year now. Boy, he went down and got a pretty good looking curveball. Not bad pitch at all. But sometimes when you have a pitcher that you see real good and that you hit real good, it doesn't matter. Even if he makes good pitches, you're just zoned in on it. And Reggie Sanders is that way against Denny Nagel.
Well, the Padres off to an early 1-0 lead here in the bottom of the first inning. Merv Rettman, his hitting instructor. Number 150 of his career and number 25 for this year. Another 2020 year for Reggie Sanders in stolen bases and home runs. His agent has already started talking with Kevin Towers about a new contract. And off the year he's had, and that'll drop in front of the dugout of the Padres and fall harmlessly for a strike. So it's a ball and two strikes. So for Reggie, looks like he's found a home here in San Diego. That line drive to left found a home about 10 rows deep down the line.
And for a personal standpoint for Reggie, boy, he really needed that to get off the September slide that he was on. He came into this ball game batting 214 in the month of September. All it takes is Denny Nagel to get him back on track.
Nevin down to third, but foul. Hey, if you have a craving for ribs, can't get to Cincinnati, order the world's greatest ribs on the Montgomery Inns mail order division. Call 1-800-USA-RIBS and your craving will be satisfied immediately. So Nagel already in a 1-0 hole. By the way, they are back playing at Pittsburgh. Pirates put another run on, 8-4 over Houston, and they're now into the fourth inning after the lengthy rain delay. Swing and a miss. Nevin's retired, but before the inning ends, Reggie Sanders cashes in his 25th round tripper of the year. Padres lead it 1-0. Dimitri Young, Eddie Taubensy, and Tucker do up. Up in the top of two, Young, Taubensy, and Tucker for the Reds, who trail it 1-0. Dimitri steps in at 3:04. What a long climb it was. When the Reds were here back in May, Dimitri was down around 200. Not only in the doldrums offensively, but in the doldrums emotionally. He wondered if he'd ever be able to get it on track again and make a dent into this 99 season. But boy, he sure has. And it's a great example of don't give up, just keep swinging and keep yourself pumped. And that's what Dimitri has done. And result, 3:04 average here in September. Eric Owens will tap the bag, and there's one away.
Well, a Buddy Carlisle is on his game. You'll see a lot of those ground balls, that is. He's got a moving fastball. As we said, he's not overpowered. Two-seam fastball that moves down and away to left-handers. Gets a lot of ground balls, 88 miles an hour, somewhere around that range. Good little curveball. What he also does is hide the ball very well. Kind of gives you a big turn like that, kind of a high leg kick, and then all of a sudden the ball is on you. Sometimes it's better to be deceptive like that than it is to be overpowering.
Eddie drills it to center field. Long run for Rivera back, and it is gone. How about that? Eddie Taubes, he picks up number 20 on the year. That's the most number of home runs by a Reds catcher since Johnny Bench had 24 back in 1980. How about that for a number? And just like that, we are even Steven at 1-1. Here's a launch job.
I'll tell you what, Eddie Taubes is some kind of strong, and he gets a changeup, so you've got to generate a lot of your own power on a swing like this. He gets that over the plate. Buddy Carlisle trying to tease him with something off speed. Into the palm tree right there, way back there.
Rivera is one of those special athletes that you never say never when he goes back to the wall. Great leaping ability. But he can't pull Taubes. He's back. It's number 20 for Eddie, and we're tied at one. Here's Michael Tucker at 245. Yeah, he got it real good. Eddie's now hitting 11 of the last 13 and over 400 during that stretch. It's gotten his average back over 300. What a tremendous offensive year Taubes he's had. Chris, last year he was right about here, the same spot, early 300s with about a month and a half left, and the wrist injury really sidetracked him. This year he stayed healthy.
It did, you know, and also this year Jack McKeon has made special effort to keep him rested from time to time. I think that Eddie Taubes, he didn't break down physically last year because he's a big, strong guy, but he got fatigued. And unless you're a catcher, and like Jack McKeon was, you don't realize what stress it is every day to go out there and catch 150, 160, 170 pitches. So he's given him plenty of rest, mixing in Brian Johnson, mixing in Jason LaRue, and that's one reason why Eddie Taubes, he's been strong right through the end of the year now.
Here's Aaron Boone after Tucker's punched out for the second strikeout for Carlisle. Aaron's in at 288. National League Player of the Week last week when he hit over 360. Dribbles this one to short. Gomez quick flip, gets Boone, and that does it for the Reds. But just like in the bottom of one, a home run puts a marker up. It's Taubes one, Reggie Sanders one, as we go to the bottom of two in San Diego.
You're left with Tony Gwynn, certainly a great hitter, but he can't carry it all on himself.
Well, home runs have told the story so far tonight, and let's go back to our Lowe's Knows Reds history. On this date last year, Brett Boone hit not one, not two, but three home runs on his way to a career-high 24 as the Reds beat the Cubs 7-3 in Chicago. Pete Harnish won his 13th that day, beating Kevin Tappany. Line drive by Rivera into the corner, foul.
And Brett didn't take an easy swing the rest of the year.
No, he wanted 30. He was going to get he was going to get a dozen in the final month. What a great year he had offensively. He's had another pretty good year this year. Rivera fouls it at his feet. No balls and two strikes. And let's go back a year ago, Chris. There were considerable rumors that the Reds and the Padres might hook up in a deal that could have brought this guy to Cincinnati as their center fielder. There were a number of trade possibilities discussed. One of them included Red shortstop Barry Larkin early in the year. None of them came to fruition. He has struggled this year offensively. Barry, of course, has been healthy all year and been the linchpin of the Reds of 1999. Three straight strikeouts for Nagel and there's two away.
Well, a matchup against Nagel and Rivera, perfect for Nagel because he's a cagey veteran who knows his stuff, knows what he can do. Rivera essentially up there with a quick bat, but really not much of an idea. And you put that up against a veteran pitcher who knows how to change speeds and all, it's going to take a major mistake on the part of Denny Nagel to give up something well hit against Rivera.
Reds baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio being brought to you by First Star, proud to be the official bank of the Cincinnati Reds. Now in the fifth, Pittsburgh 8, Houston 4. Davis sends it to left, but under it with room is Vaughn. Got it. He squeezes it, and that'll do it. Two strikeouts and a fly ball. Denny didn't like where that was placed, but he got an out anyways. Here we go to the third. Off against Buddy Carlisle. Nagel in at 179 on the year. No home runs, a run batted in. Nagel, Reese, and then Larkin. 0 and Jim Bowden made the deal with Atlanta that sent Brett Boone to the Braves. This was the guy they wanted, and it took half the season before they finally got him. But Chris, you can tell since he came back on July the 30th, and especially after his first two starts when he knew he started to feel good, the look is on his face, the game day look that we used to see in Pittsburgh and in Atlanta.
That makes a big difference too, because you know you can measure that look. He's enough of a professional that even when he went out there hurt, you know that he would give you that look. He tried to duplicate it anyway, but there was something missing in his gait, something missing in really the way he handled himself out there. But since coming back, boy, he's been 1-0 in the month of July, 3-2 in August, 3-0 now in September with an earned run average around 2.5. And Denny Nagel, boy, he has been everything advertised since coming back and being healthy.
Guzman and Nagel have been a big shot in the arm, and with 12 games left, Jack McKeon knows he needs everything he can get from his pitchers and his hitters. Here's his look at the final 2 weeks.
Well, it's all up to us, George. It's you know, our destiny's in our own hands, and we've got to put our A game together out there in this series and the rest of the season. Hopefully things will, you know, turn out okay.
12 left, and with the way the Astros have been playing, you really have to think every day, go out and put your A game out there. This is not the best time to play the Padres, though. They've been playing pretty well.
Well, the Padres, you just never know what they're going to do. You may be able to go out there and no-hit them, or they may drop a 12 spot on you. You just don't really know. The team is so inconsistent, but it has been very explosive from time to time this year. And these are sometimes the toughest type of ball clubs to play. Those that are playing very loose, that don't have a lot to play for, that are just trying to play the role of the spoiler. And you know, you face some young kids, especially like tonight, a guy like Buddy Carlisle. You know that he's got a little extra something going because he's a former Reds hand. He knows some of these guys that came up through the minor league with Carlisle. He'd like to show the Reds that they made a mistake in trading him for Buddy or for Mark Caroon.
Ball, two strikes. That's a call strike. Three to Pokey Reese, and for Carlisle, that's his third strikeout, and there are two away. The umpires for tonight, Jerry Meals is behind the plate. Hunter Wendelstadt is your first base umpire. Steve Ripley is the crew chief. He's out at second. And Mike Winters is at third. Meals, Wendelstadt, Ripley, and Winters, your umpiring crew for tonight. Two away, and here's Barry Larkin, who walked in the first. This copyrighted telecast presented by Authority of the Cincinnati Reds may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form without the express written consent of the Cincinnati Reds or Fox Sports Net, Ohio.
Yeah, it's got to be a little bit of a nervous time. You know, we talk about all the trades the Reds have made to get to this point, and most of them have been tremendous. But it just goes to show you, no matter how good you are, and Jim Bowden and his staff are about as good in the business as anybody gets, you still make trades that are going to come back and backfire sometimes. And they hope that, you know, when you give away a guy like Buddy Carlisle, based on his physical ability, they didn't think that his ceiling was all that high. They like Mark Caroon, who threw 98 miles an hour consistently with an unhittable breaking ball. But the problem with Caroon was he could never throw the ball over the plate. So here you have Carlisle. You give him away thinking, well, we don't think he's going to be much in the major leagues. And then here he is, sits himself into a situation where down the pennant race, opportunity is right there for him to really hurt the Reds. So some of the Reds people got to be sitting on a little bit of pins and needles, kind of watching Buddy Carlisle and his act out there tonight.
Well, it's interesting, too, because Jim Bowden has said all along that he asked folks in the minor league area their evaluation of Buddy Carlisle. And at that point, he said that there was only one person who thought he could pitch at the major league level. The rest thought he would not make it to the major leagues and not be a consistent winner. Here's walk number two for Larkin, two out and one on. And it, Chris, we've seen it time and time again. The radar gun is something that can be used for a lot of different ways, but certainly evaluating a pitcher solely on the fact that they throw 98 or 97 miles an hour really doesn't pan out in terms of the major leagues. People up here can hit 98, 97 mile an hour fastballs if they're over the plate. And if you can't throw strikes, it doesn't make any difference how hard you throw them. But it was worth a gamble at that point. The Reds, of course, looking for someone to help last year. As it turns out, in the long run, Carlisle would have been the better bet. But hindsight's great. In this game, it's an imprecise science.
That's what goes to show you that no matter how good you think you are, you're always going to make a trade somewhere down the road that doesn't turn out so well.
Turn that around, Ron Vallone, who was here. The Padres had Ron Vallone here, and they thought he might be the answer in their bullpen. It wasn't until he got to Don Gullett and the Reds that he has blossomed this year. Casey, right center field, Gwynn over. He won't catch up with it. It's going to be two hops to the wall. Here's Larkin around third. Barry will score, and Sean Casey will roll into second base with a two-base hit. So Casey's two-bagger gives the Reds another run, and Cincinnati has taken the lead 2-1.
Well, that ball almost looked like it was in slow motion out there. Tony Gwynn, who has lost a step defensively in right field, is playing Sean Casey a little bit down towards the right field line. That opens up the right field gap for Casey, and he hits it right in that gap.
Number 23, Greg.
A one hopper that goes to the warning track right there. With Larkin on first base and two outs, he's a cinch to score.
Number 39 on the two bag capacity for Sean Casey, and Larkin scores easily. Barry Larkin crosses the plate, and here's Vaughn for a strike. For Barry Larkin, that's the 102nd run that he scored. Here's Vaughn, who has 104 batted in and one sitting out at second with two outs. A two out lightning from the Reds, a walk and a double. And Vaughn fouls it off. One thing about when you play the team you played for last year, there's nobody in baseball that knows Greg Vaughn as well as Merv Rettman, the hitting instructor here. Rettman not only was his hitting instructor, he lived with him. I mean, he agonized through the difficult times, and he was with him through the good times as well. So you know they'll feed him a lot of breaking balls. They'll change speeds on him a lot and try to hit his weakest spot. So Vaughn knew coming here he'd be challenged.
Yeah, that's for sure. But you know, if you're a major league player, there is no secret scouting book on any one person. So anybody who's watched Greg Vaughn for a period of time is going to know how to pitch him. The question is whether your pitcher can actually execute that scouting report.
Popped into short center field. Here comes Rivera. He'll be there and he'll squeeze it. So Casey's double gives the Reds the lead 2-1. The Reds will strand one. They've stranded two through three. Here we go to the bottom of three. Gomez will lead it off.
Stretch your legs. And
fourth as we go to the third. Here's Chris Gomez. Slices it to right, almost in his tracks as Dimitri Young. He's got it and there's one away. So Gomez is retired. Denny Nagel, after the home run, is now retired five in a row, three via the strikeout route. And a reminder, the Reds baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio is brought to you by your local Ford dealer. Danny Nagel used to pitch for the Pirates in Pittsburgh. The Buccos are leading Houston right now, 8-5 in the bottom of five. Brant Brown, 2-for-3, his 15th home run. Four runs batted in. Brian Giles, 3-for-3, and two runs batted in for the Buccos. The rain delay, almost 2 hours, an hour and 42 minutes. And it's still Pirates with a lead, 8-5. That's inside to Buddy Carlisle. Good news is, Chris, he's up from the minor leagues and he's already got the pressure off. He's got a base hit. He's 1-for-5.
The other good news for him is he's in a driver's seat here, 3-0.
There's a strike, 3-1. Kilvio Veras, the switch hitter, is on deck. Ball four. So Nagel issues his first free pass. The walk to the pitcher. Hey, don't forget, Real Reds will be coming your way. Join Jeff Pecoro this week. Speaking of Danny Nagel and the shot in the arm he's given the Reds in the second half of the year. This particular show tomorrow at 12:30 will deal with Juan Guzman and the great boost that he's given. That'll be coming up next week. And this week, the Boone brothers will have a chance to sit with Aaron and Brett and talk about their rivalry and their days with the Reds. Here's Veras, one out and one on. Veras popped out to Pokey Reese down the right field line his first time up. This, of course, is a multi-purpose stadium. It used to be Jack Murphy Field. It is still Jack Murphy, but it's now called Qualcomm Stadium, the entire stadium. And for baseball, it's Jack Murphy Field. The Chargers, yep, the same team that beat the Bengals this weekend, plays football here, and they've enclosed it over the years. See out in center field, that used to be wide open. Chris, when you played here, you could look out and see the hills and the mission clocks up there on the top of the hills, but no
highway,
longer.
And then the traffic coming down Highway 8.
It's a whole different kind of stadium. Much more of a football type stadium. They've only played one football game here. I think as long as we've been coming here, this is the best this stadium has looked the last week, heading into the last week of the season.
You mean because, the playing surface?
Yeah.
Yeah.
They've only had one game and it didn't rain during that game. So the field's in pretty good shape. They'll have another football game come next week, and then the field will deteriorate rapidly, but the Padres don't care because this is their final home series. They hit the road after this and will end the series, the season, on the road. Two balls, two strikes to Kilvio. Against left-handers, 310 this year. Against right-handers, 268 is the switch hitter. On the outside corner, Veras turns and takes a look at the home plate umpire, Jerry Meals. Meals just shakes his head and says, don't say anything, and he doesn't. Here comes Mr. Gwynn. 3,053 hits this year, tied with Rod Carew for 18th place. He got number 3,000 the first week in August up in Montreal. What does 3,000 hits mean to him?
I've done it all in one uniform. I've done it all in the National League, and you know, nobody's gotten there since Lou Brock in 79. That's 20 years. The National League's a little bit tougher. You got to play every day. You got to play defense. You got to run the base. I mean, you got to do all those things in this league.
Yes, and he's proud of the fact he's been with one team and been in this league that whole time. Hard to believe, Chris, with all those. There's a line drive, but foul. All those that have gotten 3,000 hits. It's been since Lou Brock in August of 79 that we've had a National Leaguer till this year.
Well, just like Tony said, that you know, you've got to play defense every day out there. You've got to get it up and grind it out. And nowadays, it's tougher and tougher to get those hits, George, because you're seeing more and more specialists come in. You see these middle-inning relievers that come in. You may bring a guy in just to face Tony Gwynn in the sixth inning, a different pitcher to face him in the eighth, and maybe then even the closer in the ninth. So it is more and more difficult every year to be a good hitter like Gwynn is.
Well, he's passed the great Rod Carew now, 3,054. He's all alone in 18th place with that base hit, passing Rod Carew. The list just continues to grow for number 19. And they're saving the ball. Every single one of those hits this year, they've saved the baseball, and he'll get another standing ovation.
Normally, if you're a pitcher and you give up a base hit on a no ball, two strike count, you're a little bit mad at yourself. But when you do it to Tony Gwynn, he has done it for so many years to so many pitchers on all different types of two strike counts. Hey, that was a waste pitch. It was down around his ankle that he found enough wood on it to line it into right field. Ho hum, another base hit for Tony.
Find a way to put the bat on the ball. That base hit stretches his hitting streak to 15 straight. Importantly for the Padres, two on. With two outs, and Sanders, who homered his last time, is up at the plate. This time, Nagel stays away. It's outside for ball one. Milestone for Reggie tonight, too. That home run, the 150th of his career. Gets his average up to 291 now. Carlisle, the pitcher, off second. Gwynn off first. Not a lot of speed on the base pass right now. He wants the call, didn't get it. Nagel tugs bags in his belt and looks back in for a sign. Phil Nevin is on deck. Sanders over here said, let's just go slow. Let's slow you down, meaning go slow in terms of how you and I will work together, but also go slow in terms of how you approach each at bat. Don't rush. Take your time. Quiet. Quiet hands, quiet body, and you really notice the difference for those of you that have watched Reggie over the years.
You know, usually when you used to see Reggie Sanders wearing a red uniform, you'd see those hands that he'd hold the bat in a number of different locations, but it didn't really matter. He'd always have a little up and down movement right as the pitch was coming to the plate. He looked like a nervous ball of energy waiting to swing the bat up there. Much quieter now, much more relaxed.
In fact, if you notice Reggie in that approach right there, it's very similar to Greg Vaughn, which is the same thing that Rettman did with Greg Vaughn. He'll come to almost a stop and then bring his hands in, get him in hitting position, and try to coil his body to unleash towards the pitch, but not with constant motion. You'll see a similar approach by Vaughn. Take a deep breath. Bring your hands up on your shoulder and then bring the bat down in hitting position. Did he get him? Yes, he did. Good job by Nagel. The punch out for Denny Nagel, his fifth. He strands two. We're heading to the fourth in San Diego. Dimitri Young, Eddie Taubensee, and Tucker due up. Reds lead it 2-1.
Not a strike, but across the letters right there, as strong as Dimitri is, he can almost place that ball in the left center field gap.
So number 29 in the two base total for Dimitri. He's at second. Taubensee down to third off Nevin's foot. It'll go into center field. Here comes Young. They're going to send him home. Taubensee's trying for two, and he's in there. The throw will get away, and Eddie will go all the way to third. Well, the Keystone Cops took care of that one. It'll probably go as a base hit as it caromed off Nevin's foot, but then from there, Reggie Sanders picks it up and tries to get Taubensee at second after the run had already scored, throws that away, and the Reds have a runner at third and a run in. It's 3-1.
One of the most difficult plays for a third baseman to make, a shot coming off the bat of a left-hander. First of all, it surprises you, and it also has some spin on you down there, so it boots off his leg right there. And as the throw goes by the second baseman all the way almost into the dugout, a diving catch by Ben Davis keeps it from rolling in the dugout.
They bring the infield halfway, and that'll prevent Veras from getting a glove on this. And Taubensee will score as Tucker singles it into center. So just like that, on three straight pitches, a double, a single, and an error, and then another single. And the Reds have put two on the board, and they now lead it 4-1.
Michael Tucker didn't wait long. He just picked on the first pitch he saw. Buddy Carlisle elevating that sinker ball a little bit up the middle for a base hit. Boy, when you draw the infield in against a team like the Reds that can make solid contact, you're going to make them awful good as far as run producers go. Now Dave Smith out to talk to his big catcher and right-handed pitcher.
Chris, you've been out there before. You got a young catcher, a young pitcher, and this is, Dave was talking about it before the game today. He said it's been a lot of fun for him because you've got some young people who are learning and they're very adaptable to learning, but that learning process sometimes can hurt.
Especially when you do it right here at the major league level. There are so many things that are unforgiving about this league. Make a bad pitch, there's a guy that's hit 40, 50, or maybe 60 home runs waiting to crush your bad pitch. And you play a team that's in a pennant race like the Reds, and they've got that little extra something going for you that you may have as a pitcher, but maybe your teammates now waiting for the end of the season to come around, maybe they don't have that burning example going.
Tucker's running, but he's thrown out. Nice throw by Davis. So Tucker's erased on the gunshot from behind the plate.
This guy's got a tremendous arm, and regardless of what Ben Davis does at the plate as a hitter, he's probably guaranteed a job in the big leagues as a catcher because of that. A rifle of an arm back there. He threw out more than 50% of the runners in the minor leagues.
And how about this? Into the corner. Would have made a run. Boone rounds first, heads for second. And it's been like a pinball machine down at third for Phil Nevin. Nevin has produced some great offense. But those two balls back to back, one to his left, one to his right, both of them tied him up, and the Reds have another runner in scoring position with one out.
Pitcher, Denny Nichol.
Carlos Almanzar starts to loosen in the bullpen, with Carlisle being rocked for four straight hits here in the fourth. And each one was a shot. Here's Nagel, the pitcher. Gomez will have to go to first. He does. Over to third goes Boone. So with two outs, Boone's on at third. Time for our Aflac trivia question of the night. Who was the last Cincinnati Red to lead the National League in runs scored? We told you about Barry Larkin getting his 102nd run scored tonight. Who was the last Red to lead the National League in runs scored? Got to go back to the Big Red Machine era right off the top, right?
You would think so.
Probably at the top of the list, you'd think it'd be Pete.
Or may
Joe.
Not be who you think, though.
I'll have the answer coming up for you. Here's Pokey, ground out and strikeout. Four runs, six hits for the Red. A run, two hits for the Padres, and the Padres have committed an error. Have had some moments this year where they can reflect upon and say we made some strides ahead, but they've got some major questions to answer for next year. Reds know who their second baseman is going to be. It's Pokey Reese. They know Larkin will be at short. The young players they've tried have come through. Boone at third, Reese, Cameron. Jason LaRue has moved into the mix, and of course Casey over at first. Swing and a miss, Pokey, and it's two balls and two strikes. But the Padres, Nevin's won the job at third because Arias just fell flat on his face, and he's provided great offense. Will he be able to handle it defensively? A big question.
Interesting. Nevins came over here really because the Padres were in need of a backup catcher. And when Arias could not produce, they put him down to third base. Now he signed a two-year extension.
That strikeout number four for Carlisle. But Nevin, Owens, and Rivera do up as we go to the bottom of the fourth inning. Game one of this three-game series. Tuesday, Juan Guzman against Matt Clement will be on the air at 10 o'clock for that one. And then Wednesday, Ron Valone against Andy Ashby. Then the Cardinals come to town for four games, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday. We'll be on the air Friday and Sunday. And Saturday's game will be on Fox, an afternoon game. And McGuire's up to his old tricks tonight, huh, Chris?
Went deep already. Boy, it was a rude awakening over there in Chicago. For John Lieber, who started, as you say, with six and a third perfect innings, and then they dropped that seven spot on him.
First
two out home runs, one of which was by Mark McGuire.
Number 59 on the year for Big Mac. Here's Nevin, 24 home runs, 83 runs batted in. That may sound impressive, but it's even more impressive when you realize the 24 home runs and 83 runs batted in have come in only 341 at bats. It's about 55% of a season. Make your list, Chris, of your best hitting instructors and
one through five, I don't know where he would fit, but almost every year Merv Rettman is going to be on that list.
You know, after your hitting instructor, it's kind of like that for a baseball pitching instructor as well. You get to be a point where you're no longer just an instructor, you're almost a hitting guru, and I think that certainly Merv Rettman has gotten to that plateau where hitters that used to have him as a coach now call him back on his private time and say, hey, have you seen me hit? I'm in the American League now. What am I doing wrong? And he'll probably go back to basics with anybody that used to have him as a teacher and try to set him straight. There's one of them.
The Reds, of course, very fortunate to have Dennis Menke as their hitting instructor. And really, on any staff, it's not just one person. It's more than one that helps, you know, and over the years, when Tony Perez was around, whether he was a manager or a first base coach or hitting coach, he meshed with some people. Lou Piniella, no matter where he's been, has always been a hitting instructor. Same thing with Don Baylor. He's been a hitting instructor in some places, but even as a manager, he was a hitting instructor for some players on a roster. You really need to feel comfortable with whoever that person is. Sometimes it is the hitting instructor. Sometimes it's the manager or the bench coach or whoever.
Comfort level right now doesn't look like it is with Danny Nagel. After walking Nevin, he goes 2-0 to the next hitter, and it's certainly what you want to do with what Eddie Taubman's he did. Get out there, get him off the mound for a moment to take his mind off of whatever he's doing wrong. Regroup, recompose yourself, and come back and throw a strike.
Owens, big swing, 2-0. Eric going for his ninth home run. He's got 8 home runs and 57 runs batted in. It appears that he's won his spot on this roster for next year. Where is still a question mark. As a utility player, maybe in the outfield, maybe at second, depending on what happens with Veras, and as a fill-in over at third and first.
Well, Eric Owens plays the game with such enthusiasm, and he doesn't take it personally when he doesn't get the start. Not that he wants to be a utility player. He still wants to be an everyday player, but he sees the writing on the wall. He sees what left fielders have to put up as far as numbers go. Same with right fielders. He wonders if he can cover center field, so on and so forth. But as long as he's on a big league team, boy, he'll play with a lot of enthusiasm.
There's a strike, 3-2. The runner, it's inside, ball four, and back-to-back walks, numbers 2 and 3. So with no one out, there's two on for the Padres here in the bottom of the fourth. Time for our trivia answer for tonight, our Aflac trivia question. Who was the last Red to lead the National League in runs scored? Well, go back to the Big Red Machine era, but it wasn't Pete, wasn't Joe. It was the big guy, George Foster, 124 runs in 1977. Nagel trying to find a way to battle out of a situation where he's got Rivera and Davis and Gomez due up 6, 7, and 8. Foul down the left field line and out of play. Ruben Rivera has flashed some offense and defense this year, but it's come in brief spurts. The overall average has been 200 or below most of the year, but he'll have a 4-for-5 game, a 3-for-4 game, and then go 0-for-20. Very erratic, and as Bruce Bochy says, he probably should have been down at AAA this year. Broken bat, Nagel. They'll get one at second. Pokey zips it to first. They'll turn two. What a great job by Nagel. The broken bat flew by his head, and he still kept his concentration to get the ball. You've been there, Chris. This is tough.
I'll tell you what, it's not easy at all to do, because you see that whirly bird coming at you. That can be very dangerous, but boy, he keeps his focus on the ball, and he does it so aggressively. You have to know who you're going to throw the ball to before you throw the pitch. He knows it is he and Pokey Reese teaming up for this double play. He turns around and cuts it loose, knowing that Pokey's going to be there. That came at just the right time.
Not only sawed off Rivera, but turned the two. And now there's a runner at third with two outs. The Reds will keep the infield back. Here's Ben Davis, who had a fly ball to left his first time up. That's a saw job right there. Rivera saying goodbye to his former close friend.
I hardly got to know ye.
Strike one and one. Davis came up end of June, and since then you see his numbers at 262. Great opportunity for him. Very similar to Jason LaRue. Now he knows what he needs to do to be successful at the major league level. A light hopper to Larkin, who throws him out, and that'll do it. What a job by Nagel. Two straight walks, but he gets a double play and an easy ground ball. And we're going to the fifth. Larkin, Casey, and Vaughn do up. The Reds by Al's big problem areas. A home run by Eddie Taubensee. A walk to Larkin, a double by Casey produced the second run. Then four straight hits in the fourth. Double by Dimitri Young. Taubensee knocked him in and went to third after an error. A single by Tucker. And then a double by Boone. And the Reds have four on the board. Four runs, six hits, and no errors. 1-2-1 for the Padres. Larkin, two walks. And he scored a run tonight. Well, you think, as you look at this Reds team and see that they're heading towards 22 straight days without a day off before their first day off, which will come after this series, that after the long trip to the West Coast and the first game here in San Diego, they would have come to the ballpark late today. Not so. The Reds were out early. Most of the starters are here for early batting practice, well before the regular session. That tells you something about the work ethic of this club, Chris.
Well, they've got the work ethic, no question about that. They've also got that drive that they know that every time they've had some bad breaks on them, they've come back the next day or the next series and done real well. And they knew that on the plane out here, that they had to come out here and they had to take at least two out of three from this Padre ball club, preferably a sweep, of course, but you've got to win that first one.
Boomer's products to fight cystic fibrosis are award-winning barbecue sauce and salsa. Your purchase provides a donation to the Boomer Esiason Foundation to find a cure for cystic fibrosis.
I'll tell you one thing, as a former player, George, you get a lot more tired playing on a basement dwelling ball club, yeah, a team that has 50 or 60 wins on the entire year, than you do on a team that's in a pennant race.
Casey goes ripping on that fastball at strike one.
You know, you just don't have that adrenaline going when you're looking at the calendar, figuring out what you're going to do the day after the season ends. And they're doing that here in San Diego. Cincinnati, they hope that season doesn't end until close to November.
Third walk in a row for Larkin, not going anywhere on that delivery. It's up high, one ball and one strike. In the seventh inning, 8-5, the Pirates leading the Astros. Brant Brown is 15th home run after a rain delay of almost 2 hours. A little high, 2-1 at Wrigley Field. Cardinals 7-2 over the Cubs. McGuire is 59th and Thomas Howard is 5th in the winning effort for the Cardinals. Colorado Rockies beat Arizona 12-5. Wright the winner. Dahl the loser. Derek Gibson had two home runs, his first two. Six runs batted in for Gibson. Casey pops it foul and out of play. Final, Milwaukee beat Philadelphia 5-4. Jeremy Burnett hit his 33rd in that game. Dodgers lead San Francisco 2-1. They're in the third. Ortiz against Gagne. American League. Tigers got a run in the bottom of the 10th to beat the Indians 4-3. Todd Jones the winner. Dean Palmer had his 35th home run in that ball game. In the fourth, Minnesota 1, Oakland nothing. In the fourth, Kansas City 4, Seattle nothing. And Anaheim leads Tampa Bay 5-1 in the third. Steve Finley. Casey's retired. First out of the inning. That's strikeout number 5 for Carlisle.
Yeah, for a guy that's not supposed to be overpowering, 5 strikeouts already on the night for Carlisle. Very good looking changeup right there. As I said earlier, he's a little bit deceptive. He keeps got a big motion, and then all of a sudden the ball is on you. This time he takes a little bit off that pitch and has Sean Casey way out in front.
He's gotten ahead of Vaughn twice with changeups. Then he struck him out on a fastball up his first time up. Second time up, a fly ball to center in the dirt. And Larkin gets his hand in. perfect throw would have had him. It's a little bit to the shortstop side, and Barry Larkin pilfers the bag.
And that's exactly what it would have taken, because it's really stolen off the pitcher Carlisle. Coming into this ball game, Carlisle had given up four stolen bases in four attempts. Tucker thrown out earlier. This time Larkin gets a big break, but the throw by Davis just down in the dirt, and the short hops the second baseman.
Number 30 for Barry Larkin. One out in front of that changeup, swing and a miss, 1-1.
But with the same way you figure that the Padres have the right scouting report on Greg Vaughn, you figure that Vaughn has a scouting report on the Padres, how they probably will go after him. But you know that he's got a little extra something going on. He wants to hit that ball not only for a home run, but probably somewhere up there in the orange seats. When you bring that kind of desire with you, sometimes you have a tendency to overswing. We've seen Vaughn do that a couple of at-bats already tonight.
Heath Murray up and loosening in the bullpen for the Padres, a left-hander. Two balls, two strikes. Out for the second time. That strikeout number six, and Larkin still sitting at second. Here's another look.
Hey, and he's not trying to trick him either. He's going after him with a good old fastball up in the wheelhouse. But if you get it a little bit higher than the letters and a little bit inside, not middle in, but in on the corner, that's a weakness for Greg Vaughn, and he just thinks he can get onto that pitch but can't do it.
Carlisle's executed perfectly twice with that fastball up and in. He gets two against Vaughn and six strikeouts all told. Here's Dimitri, bounced to first, hit his 29th double to lead off the fourth, and later scored.
Keep in mind, as you watch Buddy Carlisle pitch, that he is only 21 years old.
I asked Dave Smith, what do you like most about Buddy Carlisle? He said his guts. That tells you all you need to know. Not afraid. He said he's got a lot to learn, but he's not afraid to learn up here. And sometimes young pitchers are afraid once they get up here. And he's got a couple of guys like that. Matt Clement is another one. Clement had a rough start first half of the year, has bounced back and had a series of good starts here in the second half. So they got the nucleus of a pretty good rotation. There's Dave Smith, former outstanding reliever. He said, maybe we're not going anywhere in the postseason, but I tell you, I had fun this year. What more could you ask for?
Tell you what, there's a guy that was long on guts.
Yep. He pitched a lot of times when the arm was hanging about a foot lower than the other one. Two-two to Dimitri. Slap to left. It'll be a foul ball. Thought he had found the seam for another two bagger. Missed it by about 8 feet, and he'll go back and try it again. When the game started tonight, 7 o'clock start, San Diego time, looked like there might have been about 15, 18 fans in the ballpark. But boy, Chris, they've been filing in all night long.
All of a sudden, it's like a pretty good house.
It looks like we'll have over 30,000, maybe 35 to 40. They keep coming in, and Carlisle gets his third strikeout of the inning, 7 for the game. Buddy Carlisle gets through 5 with 7 punchouts. The Reds lead it 4-1. Gomez, Carlisle, and Barris do up.
Choose your minivan from the most luxurious Chrysler Town & Country Limited to America's lowest priced Voyager. You'll find it all in a Chrysler or Plymouth minivan. Maybe that's why Voyager won a Consumer's Digest Best Buy 10 years in a row. And maybe that's why more people choose from our family of minivans than any other.
You've dreamed about it your whole life. You've heard about it before. Now here's your chance to make the majors. Join us at Reds Baseball Heaven 2000, the Cincinnati Reds Adult Baseball Program. If you're over 30, here's your chance to turn back the clock to the days of your youth. For $37.95, suit up with the likes of Nuxall, Flynn, Gullett, Youngblood, Maloney, Billingham, and many more. February 6th through February 13th. For more information on this dream of a lifetime, call 1-800-755-REDS. That's 1-800-755-7337.
In the War of 1812, Captain Isaac Hall of the USS Constitution royally defeated Britain's finest warships. In 1862, Commander of the Monitor, John Warden, battled the Merrimack. It was an ironclad victory. And today, Steve and Nancy, captains of their bowling team, claim victory on this battleship, the $3 instant game from the Ohio Lottery. Sink all five ships and win up to $25,000 instantly. The battleship game from the Ohio Lottery. Step aboard today.
The U.S. Census Bureau. The report reveals that by the time 1 year passes by, the average American family will watch 1,800 hours of television, consume 998 soft drinks, wash 2,000 pounds of laundry, and save over $1,100 shopping at Vicks.
$1,100.
And sports. The Knights lose a heartbreaker at home.
We'll take it.
After this.
Vicks. Minimum price.
Here we go to the bottom of the fifth. Chris Gomez hitting eighth in the order, leads it off and pops it up. Gomez, fly ball to right, his first time up. The pitcher Carlisle is due up next. But Gary Matthews Jr. has moved into the on-deck circle, so Carlisle's night may be done. He's on the short end of a 4-1 score. He's pretty big to be Sarge's little guy, huh? He's a pretty good-looking specimen, Chris. Oh and two. Popped into short center field. Tucker over, he's got it. And there's one away. Hey, Reds, playoff tickets for the Division Series and League Championship Series are now on sale. You may purchase tickets for one or all three possible division home games and one or all four possible NLCS home games. Tickets are available at the Synergy Field Advance Ticket Window, all Ticketmaster outlets, Dugout Shop at the Westin, by phone at 513-421-REDS, and online at www.cincinnatireds.com. So postseason tickets are available now. Now in the top of eight, Pittsburgh 8 and Houston 5. And here's Gary Matthews Jr. pinch hitting for Carlisle. Murray continues to toss in the bullpen for the Padres, so he'll take over. Since coming up, 222, no home runs, three runs batted in for this fine young prospect. We saw Ruben Rivera come up and look like this when he first came up 2 years ago, Chris, and Matthews has all the tools. It's just a question of some seasoning.
Absolutely right, George. Boy, he had a big cut on that first pitch he saw from, or the first pitch he swung at from Denny Nagel. Quick bat, a lot of athletic ability, but of course against a guy like Nagel, the same way it has been a matchup with Rivera. Get the figure of this. Very much an advantage of the pitcher right here. Nagel knows what he's got to do, be able to change speeds a little bit. Just can't make a mistake out there where the young kid can put the head of the bat on it. Because he'll chase some pitches if you give him a chance.
Of course, he's the son of veteran major leaguer Gary Matthews, who's now the batting instructor for the Toronto Blue Jays.
And a good one.
Mm-hmm. Good spot for it. Matthews swings and misses, so Matthews is retired. And that is strikeout number six for Denny Nagel, two away here in the fifth inning.
That's some front office news today, George, over in Colorado, of course, with the exiting of their general manager and, of course, Jim Leland, the manager at the end of the year. They named Dan O'Dowd, former front office employee of the Cleveland Indians, assistant up there to take over as general manager of the Rockies, and now speculation in the Rocky Mountain News this afternoon that he will go after Buddy Bell, try to name him the field manager.
That's pretty clear that Dan O'Dowd has a lot of people he's close with, many of them in the Cleveland organization, and certainly Buddy is one of them. Buddy, of course, just recently promoted to the director of player development for the Reds. And Chris, and we talked to him the other night, and he said, yeah, he still is interested in managing at some point in time. No specific place, but he would only go someplace if he had a good relationship with a general manager. And certainly Dan O'Dowd would fit that description. Here's Barris, the leadoff hitter. Two balls, no strikes. The problem is, if you were to hire Buddy Bell, and it'd be great for Buddy's, he's an outstanding manager, and he will be again a good manager in, at the major league level. In all probability, you'd lose half of the minor league instructors you have. You got Freddie Kendall, who is a coach with him, and Sammy Ellis.
Maybe some of your major league instructors too.
Ronnie Oster is very
close
with him.
Perhaps Davey Collins.
Harris pops it up. So this will probably be one of the most active postseasons ever in baseball. General managers and managerial jobs will be popping up like wildfire in the next couple of months. We'll talk more about it when we return. Denny Nagel is sitting on a 4-1 lead as we go to the sixth.
Pitcher will be a left-hander and Ohio native from Troy, Ohio. Here's Heath Murray, 6'4", big lefty, comes in relief. He started 7 games for the Padres early in the year. Now he's in pretty much relegated to relief appearances. 12 of his last 13 appearances have been out of the bullpen.
Well, here's Eddie Taubensy. Taubensy homered his first time up to tie the game at 1, his 20th of the year. And then reached on a base hit in the fourth inning that knocked in the third run for Cincinnati. And eventually went to third on an error by Reggie Sanders as Sanders tried to throw him out at second. 1-1 to Eddie. Line drive, left field, base hit, and Taubensy's 3-for-3. Leadoff hit here in the sixth inning. Against San Diego this year, he's now hitting over 500. He was 471 coming in. And he's picked up his 20th home run of the year.
You know, if you want to play the Padres, you really don't want to have to come into Qualcomm Stadium to do it, because this is a very good ball club at home. In fact, they've won more home games than the Reds have won home games. 12 games over 500, the Padres are here in San Diego.
Been a streaky team. Here's Tucker, strikeout and a single. The Padres, remember earlier this year, had the longest win streak in the National League. They won 14 in a row. In one stretch, they were 24-7 after a tough start. And then the bottom fell out in July. They were 8-26. And now coming into tonight, they've won 15 of the last 23, 15-8 in their last 23 games. So they've been playing some fine baseball. Now bottom of the eighth inning at Pittsburgh, 8-5. Pirates continue to lead Houston. And speaking of a team that's playing well, the Pirates have a chance to finish 500 or better. They need a win streak in these final 2 weeks. Well, with two left-handers, Taubensy and Tucker, due up at the bottom of the order, they go with a left-hander, Heath Murray. He gives up a hit to Taubensy. Now he's a ball and two strikes to Tucker. Got it. First strikeout for Murray. Eighth red to go down on strikes tonight.
Well, if you chart Heath Murray, you find out that he gives up a higher batting average to left-handers than to right-handers. 341 overall. Lefties hit off of him. It did not look like that. An added bat against Michael Tucker. Looked like he's got a nice little slider, and he painted it in right the spot, in just the right spot.
So one out. Here's Aaron Boone. 1-for-2, a double. for Aaron Boone whenever he does come here from Southern California. His mom always makes it to the park, and his granddad, grandma, usually are here. And he's hopeful either today or tomorrow that his younger brother Matt will come to the ballpark too. Matt, of course, a draftee of the Detroit Tigers, playing in the minor leagues with them. Down to third, but foul. There's Ronnie Oster, your third base coach. Over at first, as usual, Davey Collins for the Reds tonight. Tauvitz, he singled. He's still on first with one out. Boone trying to get him around. Three and two. Reds baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio is brought to you tonight by your local Mercury dealers. Imagine yourself in a Mercury now. Three, two, checking to see if Taubensy will be off and running. One-handed, didn't spill the, didn't spill the plate. That's big. Look at that. Didn't even spill a drop.
He knew if he spent $500 on a seat, he'd end up with a souvenir.
Well, the sushi probably cost $500. 3-2 again. They get him, and they got Taubensy caught between first and second. And it's a strike him out, throw him out, double play. Now the Reds get a hit in the inning. They're seventh in the ball game, but that runner's wiped out. We're going to the bottom of six. Gwynn, Sanders, and Nevin do up. New trolley system that goes from the downtown area all the way out to the ballpark. They put it in for the Super Bowl, and just a tremendous way to see the city area and then get out to a ball game too.
I'll tell you what makes coming out to the ballpark very easy, because it's not very easy, that is, they're quick to get out of the stadium here. They've got a lot of traffic problems after Charger games, after Padre games that have a lot of people in them, and you know, mass transportation is one thing that they've taken very seriously here in San Diego.
Here's Tony Gwynn, dribbles it down to second. Reese throws him out. Tony 1-for-3, base hit number 3054, moved him into sole possession of 18th place, past Rod Carew. Here's Jack McKeon, the man who drafted him, talking about him.
I saw him tonight when I went to talk to him and told him I wish, you know, congratulated him and wish I could have been here to see it. But and I did tell him that, hey, when you get to the Hall of Fame, I'll be there. And he's a great kid, and, you know, he hasn't forgot his roots, and he hasn't forgot the people that were good to him in the early years. And I consider him a very, very close personal friend.
Feeling mutual for Tony Gwynn to Jack McKeon. So Gwynn's 1-for-3, one out here in the sixth, and here's Reggie Sanders. Homer to give the Padres a 1-0 lead in the first, and he struck out in the third. Denny Nagel already with six strikeouts, tying his season high. Missing away, two balls and no strikes. Pretty good year for the former Reds outfielder, who's seemingly found a home here in Southern California. In fact, he's talking, if he does wind up signing a multi-year deal and staying here, which will probably happen in the offseason, he'll probably move here. at Sanders by a step, and there's two away. Fox Sportsnet Ohio welcomes our viewers watching on RNA Management Cable TV in Russell Point, Ohio.
Third baseman.
And TSC Communications in Wapakoneta, Ohio. Thanks for watching Reds Baseball on Fox Sportsnet Ohio. Danny Nagel had trouble in the first, the home run by Reggie Sanders. Got himself into trouble in the fourth with his second and third walks of the ball game, but got out of it with a double play ball off the bat of Rivera and then a ground ball to short. Had a 1-2-3 fifth and got the first two outs here in the sixth. Make it a 1-2-3-6. Nevin bounces out. Nevin's 0-for-2 and a walk. We're going to seven. Nagel due to lead it off, and the Reds have a three-run lead.
It's a constant, and no shortstops have ever gone 1-2 in a batting race. Jeter, more RBI, Nomar, 46 points higher in slugging. On the other hand, Jeter, 16 points higher in on-base average. Even more remarkable, both are also outstanding fielders. So, now, Ray, what is the difference? Where is there a difference? Is there a difference?
Well, I hate to talk about people that are this great and create a negative anywhere. I think Nomar is more of a middle-end type hitter. Likes the ball middle end, pulls the ball a little bit more. When he gets in trouble, he can go to right field, but he likes the ball middle end where he can drive the ball. On the other hand, Jeter is more of an inside-out swinger, liking the ball away from him, pulls a breaking ball, can really jump on the fastball if he's looking inside. One big difference that I've noticed, Nomar has only punched out 39 times. When he swings the bat, he puts the ball in play. Jeter, on the other hand, 107 punch-outs. I think with the fact that Fenway Park is such a great hitting ballpark, and that Nomar can use that wall to his advantage. Very difficult to punch him out. I think Nomar is going to win the batting title.
Ray, it's absolutely amazing. Kurt Schilling said to me he had never seen anybody who put the fat part of the bat on the ball all the time the way Nomar did. I said, well, if you look at his bat, he's just got this one little mark. He hits it in the same place. He's broken five bats in 2 years, except for about the 20 he's broken up the runway.
Reds, and guess who's coming to town? Mark McGwire and the Cardinals roll in for the final homestand of the season. Four-game series includes a 7:05 game Friday, 1:15 Saturday, Sunday, 12:35 season finale on Monday. Don't miss your last chance to see the Reds in action against Mark McGwire, September the 24th through the 27th. Big Mac hit his 59th home run in a win over the Chicago Cubs today. Gomez scoops, throws, and Nagel's retired. Denny, three ground balls to short. He's kept Gomez in business tonight. One out here in the seventh inning.
Well, this is the last homestand for the Padres of these games against the Cincinnati Reds. And, of course, this weekend, the last homestand of the Reds against the St. Louis Cardinals. Big crowds expected, and the Reds have gone into some extra plans to try to make it easy to get through the ballpark. They've got the same park and ride shuttle system that they've had for a couple of other series in the year. You'll be able to take those from different locations around Western Hills Plaza, Forest Park, Fields Erdl, Anderson Township, up over in Beachmont Avenue. $3 for a round trip. Try to alleviate some of that ingress and egress problem they have around Synergy Field, and hopefully those people will take advantage of that pretty good deal. So if you're interested in that, call the Stadium Authority or the Metro Authority at 513-621-4455 for information about the shuttle.
One out, here's Pokey Reese, two strikeouts and a ground out, 0-for-3. In the bottom of the eighth at Pittsburgh, Kevin Young, a two-run single. Pirates 10, Houston 5. Bucco's still batting, bottom of eight. Two of the series tomorrow, Juan Guzman against Matt Clement. And then Wednesday, it's Ron Valone against Andy Ashby to wrap the season series up with the Padres. Reds going in tonight have won four of the six games between these two teams. Cincinnati started the night 3.5 games back of Houston in the Central Division. And in the wild card chase, four games back of New York. Mets are idle tonight, of course. They play Atlanta tomorrow. So the Reds can pick up a half game if it stays the way it is right now on the Mets, and a full game on the Astros. Tony Gwynn has it. Pokey Reese retired. Murray's got the first two batters in the seventh. And here comes Barry Larkin, who has walked all three times he's come to the plate. Padres in the process of getting a new stadium here for baseball only. This will be just a football stadium, and the Padres will have a brand new stadium downtown by the Bay Area. Should be a great setup when it's finalized. One ball, one strike to Barry Larkin. Buddy Carlisle started, went five innings, six hits, four runs, struck out seven and walked three. Nagel's gone all six for the Reds thus far. One run, two hits. On the night. 3-1 delivery is wide. Time to check our Ohio Lottery winning numbers for tonight on the late draw. Pick 3, 987, 987. Pick 4, 1567, 1567. And Buckeye 5, 16, 24, 27, 29, 30. 16, 24, 27, 29, 30. Hope you had a winner tonight in the Ohio Lottery. Here's the Reds' first baseman, Sean Casey. Bounced into a fielder's choice, hit his 39th double of the year to knock in Larkin in the third, give the Reds a 2-1 lead, and he struck out in the fifth against Buddy Carlisle. Barry has already stolen one base tonight, his 30th of the year. Standing in after the base hit tonight, still at 334 on the year. Going into play this evening, Larry Walker had a 380 average to lead the league. Bobby Abreu at 340, Carl Everett 336, and Casey at 334. Towards the hole, Nevin has it bounce off the glove. They'll go to second and get the out. Nevin didn't quit on it and got the force at second. So the Reds leave a runner stranded in the seventh. We're going to the bottom of seven. Owens, Rivera, and Davis do up. Cincinnati by three. Year from the offseason when the Dodgers spent all that money, and you got to feel there will be a little extra when those two meet for the final time.
Well, the first taste of victory, of course, goes to Kevin Towers, the GM here at the Padres, because he wanted to make sure that the Dodgers did not win. Kevin Malone, so prophetic, what he wanted to be anyway, back in coming out of spring training, saying, well, let everybody know the Dodgers are back. You know, put it into books. They're going to be in the postseason. Well, they wanted down here in San Diego to do nothing else but guarantee the Dodgers did not make it to the playoffs. Well, that first part of victory has to be very tasty to Kevin Towers in San Diego. Secondly, if you could beat them out for third place, that would even be bigger. So, you're right. A little bit of grudge points at risk.
Here's Rubin. He struck out his first time up and then bounced into that double play. Two balls and one strike. By the way, in case you are wondering, Rob Butcher has answered the question for us. Barry Larkin, four walks tonight. Who's the last Red with four walks in a game?
How about Johnny Bench?
Last with four is Reggie Sanders, the 10th of September of 98 against the Cardinals. The last with five was JB.
Oh, that was JB.
Back in 79. Hey, by the way, it's Pringle Pack Day at the ballpark on Saturday, September 25th. The Reds take on the Cards at 1:15. The first 40,000 fans receive a free Pringle Pack. Head to the Reds' last Saturday game of the season. Get a special Reds carrying case for your Pringles. Get your tickets now for Pringle Pack Day Saturday when the Reds take on the Cardinals at 1:15. Rivera's retired. Here's Davis. to center field there to make the catch is Tucker. He's cruising. Denny Nagel has three straight 1-2-3 innings. The Reds have a three-run lead. Here we go to the eighth. Vaughn will lead it off.
This time it's a right-hander, a big guy, Domingo Guzman. He made his major league debut not too long ago. He's only been in four games, make that five games now. Hard-throwing right-hander out of the Dominican Republic.
So Heath Murray went two innings, allowed a hit, and struck out two. Walked one batter, following Carlisle's five innings, six hits, four runs, and seven strikeouts. Domingo Guzman takes over. He'll face Vaughn, Dimitri Young, and Eddie Taubensee, the Reds' top of eight. They're going to the top of the ninth inning at Pittsburgh, 11-5. The Pirates lead the Astros. Greg Vaughn tonight, two strikeouts and a fly ball. Bloop to right. This will sink and drop for a hit. So Vaughn has a broken bat, base hit to lead off the top of the eighth inning. Last 13 games, Vaughn has kept up his part of the bargain. He's hit 360. And you know about his on-fire month of September. He's been spraying long balls over parks all over the National League. 11 home runs and 23 runs batted in September. Here's Dimitri. 29th double of the year in the fourth. Started the Reds rally. That's off the glove of Owens. Dimitri will be on. It's first and second. It'll go as a base hit, but you can see by watching the game tonight that the Padres, position to position, are defensively a little short.
Yeah, and they maybe physically at first base, too. You see down there trying to get up to get that ball, Eric Owens, who not normally you would say the perfect profile first baseman. Usually, even in Little League, George, when you're making out your lineup, you put the biggest guy over first base, makes the biggest target. He makes up for it in energy, that's to be sure. But the Reds have gotten some breaks, some base hits off the Padres' gloves, some misplays by the Padres, and that's why they've got a three-run lead. Perfect opportunity here to do a little add-on.
So an infield hit for Dimitri. He's 2-for-4. Mike Cameron will pinch hit for him. So the Reds have Vaughn and Cameron on, and here's Eddie Taubensee, who's 3-for-3. Homer is 20th the year. Doubled into short left and single to left. Back in the second. Here's our Ohio Lottery instant replay, Chris.
Boy, he hit this a ton. Eddie Taubensee did. Got a changeup out over the plate, had to generate his own power, and into the palm trees for one run.
Hit in 11 of his last 13. Shows bunt, gets it down, but foul.
Domingo Guzman, a very talented right-hander. There's Dimitri. This kid's got a very explosive fastball, and he gets it in on your hands right there. I think that really surprised Eddie Taubensee trying to get that bunt down the third baseline. It just bore in on him so quick he couldn't get the bat on it.
Get two more runners in scoring position is Taubensee after the bloop hit to right and the infield hit. That's a little outside. 2-1. Hey, you're the chef with JTM's new beef or chicken Philly cheesesteaks that you make right at home. Add your own seasonings and you've got the perfect sandwich. So when you're the chef, make your meal fun with JTM's new beef or chicken Philly cheesesteaks. Guzman will hit him in the back. Here comes Vaughn to the plate. The throw will not be in time, and the Reds get another run. Vaughn turned the bag and just kept rolling to the plate. Guzman took a little bit extra time, and the throw will looks like it clips Taubensee in the back. I don't know whether Owens got a glove on it. Take a look.
Very nonchalant the way Guzman comes off the mound to get to that. Looks like he had all day, and he did, but he shows off his gun right here, but he throws it up the baseline. He hits Taubensee as he crosses the bag, so Eddie will be safe, and then Greg Vaughn refuses to stop. He runs right around third base. There he comes on to home. Ben Davis doesn't block the plate right here, so the abbreviated slide by Greg Vaughn just in time and ahead of the tag.
So Tucker will come to the plate. The Reds put another run on the board, and they lead it by a score of 5-1. You would assume that it would be an infield hit and an error. They as yet have not put anything up on the board. Could go as a straight error. First and third for the Reds. Single and an error. So Taubensy has a 4-for-4 night. Eddie will take it. And the error will go on the pitcher. That's the second error of the night. Reggie Sanders apparently tried to throw to second with Taubensy up. Tucker drills it. It's a fair ball into the corner. Here comes Cameron. He'll score. Taubensy will round third. They're going to send him home. Wynn's throw won't be in time to the cutoff man. The Reds put two more on. So Michael Tucker cruises into third as that one got hung up. And it is in play in the bullpen area as long as it does not get stuck behind something or in something. So it goes as a three-base hit. The Reds put two more on the board, and they now lead it 7-1.
Big hit right here by Michael Tucker. He'll drive in a couple of them. Boy, the fastball left right out over the plate. Excellent fastball hitter when you give him some room. And he gets it down there. This is the more treacherous, one of the most treacherous places to try to field a ball in all the baseball right there. Who knows what grows under that bullpen bench? Tony Gwynn's got to reach in there and grab it. And Bruce Bochy will go out to the bullpen and grab a new pitcher.
And while the pitching change takes place and Carlos Reyes comes in, we'll take time out for these messages. We're watching Reds baseball on Fox Sports.
It'll be Carlos Almanzar, former Toronto Blue Jay, will face Aaron Boone. Almanzar appeared in 25 games last year for the Blue Jays and came over in the Woody Williams trade that sent Joey Hamilton over to Toronto. He, unlike Guzman, is much more of a control pitcher, change-up slider pitcher rather than the fastball pitcher of the departed Guzman.
Guzman faces four batters, doesn't retire one, four hits and an error. That produced three runs. Reds lead it 7-1. Here's the 0-2 to Boone with the infield in to try to cut off the runner Tucker at third. Final now, Pittsburgh beats Houston 11-5. Shane Reynolds defeated by the Buccos tonight 11-5. Pittsburgh over Houston. We'll have more details coming up a little bit later. Brant Brown did homer in that game early. Off the end of the bat, Owens will have it. So if it stays the way it is right now, the Reds will pick up a full game on the Astros to move to within 2.5.
That's big.
Everyone's big at this stage.
I'll tell you, you know, a week ago, the way the Astros were playing, people in Cincinnati were morose, thinking, well, they're not ever going to lose again. But every team, even no matter how good or bad they are, goes through some bad periods, and their pitching has faltered a little bit over the last three or four games. Although they won yesterday, they've got beat up pretty good tonight. Shane Reynolds, the starting pitcher tonight, apparently got rocked.
Nagel loops it to center. That's a base hit. It'll score Tucker. Here comes the eighth run for the Reds. Danny Nagel, after three ground balls to short, comes through with his second run batted into the year, and the Reds now lead it 8-1.
Open to bat on the ball. Good swing right there for Danny Nagel with a man on third base and two out. He picks up that RBI. RBI number two of the year for the left-hander.
Reds 8, Padres 1, Nagel on as Tucker scoots home with the run. Here's Pokey Reese, 0-for-4 and 2 strikeouts at the top of the order. Reds baseball on Fox Sports Net Ohio being brought to you by the new Dodge. Stop by and see the winning lineup of cars, trucks, minivans, and SUVs at the friendly Dodge dealer near you. Well, the one thing, Chris, that is assured as you look at the departed Domingo Guzman, both the Reds and the Astros have the kind of clubhouses that just will not quit in the final 2 weeks. These are two teams that have gritted it out all season long, whether it be injury or hardship or whatever. They just keep coming back at you. And I think, as Jack McKeon said in our pregame interview, you really can't worry about them. You just got to go out every night and try to win, and maybe some good things will happen.
Well, yeah, you know, and some of those good things will be that you continue your winning ways. One thing leads to another, and the snowball gets bigger and bigger. I think from the Red standpoint and the fan standpoint, everybody wants to see them make the postseason. But I think at this point, they just want to keep it close enough so that when they go through Houston and they play those two games next week against the Astros in the Dome, that they're still within striking distance enough that if they were able to win two games in Houston, really make it a run.
And one of the keys at this time of year, you want to be intense but not tense. In other words, play an intense brand of baseball, but don't tense up so you're not doing the little things that you can do to win. And these are two teams that have pretty much done that down the stretch run.
You know, the big question mark, George, at least in my mind now, is that with the six games remaining between the New York Mets and the Atlanta Braves, now with Brian Jordan likely out for the year with his hand injury, how big a blow is that to lose your number four hitter? The Braves, for the first time in a long time, find themselves in a divisional race.
Here's Gookie Dawkins, who's pinch hitting for Barry Larkin. Larkin walked four times, all four times he came to the plate. Gookie, what an outstanding year he had. Baseball Weekly's 1999 Minor League All-Star honorable mention this year. Had a great year for the Reds in the minors. Was part of Buddy Bell's Pan Am team as well. Now, Chris, we saw him in spring training. He always has flashed a good glove. What's impressed me more than anything since seeing him the second time after half a season of baseball this year was his approach at the plate. He shortened his swing measurably. He looks more aggressive and he looks more comfortable at the plate.
Oh, he's come a long way, of course. You know, you can almost liken him to Pilkey Reese a couple of years ago, who had to make that transition of shortening his stride a little bit, shortening his swing, trying to make contact, and Pokey's a very good hitter at this point. Same thing happens, you know, once around the league for Gookie, pitchers will begin to know him and it'll be tough for him for a while, and then he'll be able to make some adjustments and become a good major league hitter. That all in the future.
And ball, two strikes to Dawkins on the outside corner. The rookie always gets the tough call, and Gookie gets that call right there. So the eighth batter, punch out victim of Almazar, and that's your second out of the inning.
First baseman, Sean Casey.
That'll bring up Sean Casey, ninth batter for the Reds this inning. Eight runs, 13 hits for Cincinnati, a run, two hits for the Padres. Casey tonight doubled in a run to give the Reds a lead, 2-1 back in the third. That was his 39th two-bagger of the year. Two on, two out. Two balls and no strikes down and in. Now in the fifth inning up at Dodger Stadium, Dodgers 4 and Giants 2. Center field base hit. Around third comes Nagel. Here comes the throw to the plate. It will not be in time, and Denny Nagel scores. Sean Casey has his second hit. The Reds played another.
Base hit up the middle right there. That will score Denny Nagel. He's got a hustle with two strikes here, or two outs. He's got a head start right there. But Rivera, a very good arm, as you see from the outfield. So Denny Nagel, what they'll tell him when he gets back in the dugout, how many more runs you need, pal? Maybe we ought to save some for tomorrow.
9-1 Cincinnati. The Reds have batted around. Here's Vaughn, who started it all with a bloop single to right. Nine runs, 14 hits for the Reds. Pirates have already lost 11-5. Cardinals beat the Cubs 7-2. Mark McGuire's 59th home run in that one. Jose Silva got the win for Pittsburgh. Shane Reynolds took the loss for Houston in that game at Three Rivers. The Pirates have something to shoot for, too. That pulls them to within one game of 500. They're now 74-75 on the year. Already completed. Milwaukee beat Philadelphia 5-4. Jeremy Burnett's is 33rd homer of the year. 2-1 to Vaughn. score on the game from Pittsburgh. 11 runs, 14 hits, and an error for the Pirates. 5-9-2 for the Astros. In the winning effort, Brant Brown, 3-for-5, including his 15th home run of the year. Nunez was 2-for-4, and Brian Giles, 3-for-4. Vaughn hits it pretty good to left, going way back to the wall. It's going to be gone. Number 41 for Greg Vaughn, a three-run shot. That'll make it a 12-to-1 ball game. Well, he started slow tonight, 0-for-3, but his last two at-bats have come in this eighth inning, and they've produced for the Reds. Home run number 41 gives the Reds a 12-to-1 lead. That's now 107 runs batted in for Greg Vaughn.
First Reds player in the decade to have 100 or more RBI. Greg Vaughn gets 105, 6, and 7 on this three-run blast. Eight runs in the eighth. And to think, George, that this is the first 100 RBI player the Reds have had in this decade. The Rockies have had 15 in the last 5 years. The Indians have had 20 in the decade of the 90s. This goes to show you how important having somebody in that lineup who can drive some runs is.
Well, you look at the decade, and really since 90, after 90, you had Eric Davis for 1 year, Ron Gant for 1 year, and that's really the decade of the 90s for the Reds. This is the first time that the Reds have had a bona fide number four hitter, and he's produced. Number 23 had 50 home runs for this team last year. He's got 41 for the Reds right now. Dave Smith out talking to his right-hander to try to calm him down, as the Reds have sent 10 to the plate and scored 8 here in the eighth inning and lead it 12-1. In that Pittsburgh Astro game, Shane Reynolds started in his the loser 16-12. He went 2 2/3 innings, 7 hits and 8 runs, 5 of them earned. Francisco Cordova started till the rain hit. They had an hour and 42 minute rain delay that came in the bottom of the third inning. Pete Shurik is giving credit for the victory. He went 3 2/3, 3 hits, 1 run. So the board had Silva down, but it is Shurik. Pete Shurik gets the win for the Reds. He's for the Pirates. He's 4-7. Final, 11-5 Pittsburgh. Cameron, who came in as a pinch runner, swings and misses, and it's 3-2. Yeah, we're on the air tomorrow at 7 o'clock Pacific time, 10 o'clock back home time. Juan Guzman against Matt Clement. Right center field, Rivera calling. He's got it, and that'll do it. But the Reds send 11 to the plate. They put 8 on the board and lead it 12-1. Last roundup time, Greg Vaughn says, go get him, Denny Nagel. It's your complete game out there.
Chevrolet cars are trusted by more Americans than any other.
The numbers for Denny Nagel, 1 run, 2 hits. That's all the Padres have gotten tonight. The run came on Reggie Sanders, 25th home run of the year in the first inning. Tony Gwynn singled in the third. Popped up into short right. Tucker calling, he's got it. Defensive changes for the Reds. Bookie Dawkins stays in the game at short for Barry Larkin. Mike Cameron stays in the game. He's in center field. And Jeffrey Hammonds is in and left. So it's Hammonds in left, Cameron in center, and Michael Tucker moves from center to right. Casey, Reese, Dawkins, Boone across the infield, and Eddie Taubes is still behind the plate. Wiki Gonzalez will pinch hit for the pitcher. Gonzalez, another one of the minor league catchers called up, and he's a good one. In fact, the Padres will have some decisions to make next year behind the plate. You know about Carlos Hernandez. He was the starting catcher, blew out his Achilles tendon in spring training, so he's missed the whole season. He's just now, look out, this one hit a ton to left. Does Hammonds have room? Warning track, wall, got it. Well, maybe on a warmer night, that one may have cleared the wall, but on a damp night tonight here in San Diego. That hung up, and Hammonds pronto gets pinned up against the wall. Two away. But Chris, you figure that if the season were to start tomorrow and Carlos Hernandez was healthy, he'd be the number one catcher. Mm-hmm. But what do you do with Ben Davis? Do you leave him here to back up, or do you send him a AAA where he'll play every day? It'll be a tough decision for the Padres. Lucky 13 for Danny Nagel. We'll go back to the fourth inning. Nagel walked the first two batters in the fourth inning. At that point, it was a 4-1 ball game. That's when this game turned around. He stepped back off the mound, barked at himself, came back, got a double play ground ball from Rivera, got Davis on a ground ball to short. Then it was a 1-2-3 fifth, 1-2-3 6, 1-2-3 7th, and he's got two outs here in the eighth. Two strikes to the leadoff hitter, Kilvio Veras. 0 for 3, two pop-ups to Pokey Reese, and a strikeout. Out as many as 12 in a game. This year is season high is 6, which he's matched tonight. Tucker heading towards the corner, under it. Got it. That'll do it. Another 1-2-3. 14 straight for Danny Nagel. We're heading to the top of 9. Reds 12-1.
New batter for the Reds, it'll be Brian Johnson. A new pitcher for the Padres, right-hander Matt Whiteside. Pitcher number 5 on the night for Bruce Bochy's crew as they look at an 11-run deficit. Whiteside in for the 7th time. Forget the earned run average. He's only pitched 6 2/3 innings.
93-mile fastball waved at for 1-1 for Brian Johnson, who pinch hits for Taubensy. What a night Eddie had. 4 for 4, including his 20th home run of the year. Also had 3 runs batted in for Eddie tonight. Stan Belinda throwing in the bullpen for the Reds. Danny Nagel has pitched 8 brilliant innings, allowing only 2 hits, but on a night where he threw a lot of pitches early, his evening may be over. At 237, 5 home runs, 18 runs batted in. Tucker in the on-deck circle and Aaron Boone to follow. 6, 7, and 8 for Cincinnati. Reds 12 runs, 15 hits, no errors. Padres 1 run, 2 hits, 2 errors. Pick up a hit on this night, 1 for 3, and he's due up. He was due up for being replaced this inning. Gwynn 1 for 3, and with that, 3,054 is his career total. Moves into sole possession of 18th place. Johnson's retired. That's strikeout number 1. Here is your star of the game, your first star of the game, Danny Nagel. He will not return for the 9th inning. He's exiting. 8 innings, 2 hits, a run, 3 walks, 6 strikeouts. He was in control tonight, Chris.
He really was. You know, there were a couple of scary moments in the first inning and then in the fourth inning when he loaded the first couple of guys on base due to the base on balls, but he got a ground ball double play. And when the Reds scored a few runs behind him, he just began to feed off that and really stayed in control. This is the way the Reds ought to be able to play this Padre team.
Get ahead early and stay ahead. Cincinnati is winning here 12-1. The Pirates have already beaten Houston, so the Reds can cut a full game off the deficit in the Central Division to 2.5 and 3.5 in the wild card chase behind the Mets. Mets and the Braves play each other the first of two series beginning tomorrow. Final in Pittsburgh, 11-5, Pirates over the Astros. Miss on Tucker, so Whiteside is punched out two here in the ninth.
Well, George, with the Mets going and hosting the Atlanta Braves for that first of the six games that they'll play in the last couple of weeks of the season. They'll play in Shea Stadium the next few nights. You think the gentleman over there at Portobello have a special message for the Braves on the way to the ballpark?
For the Reds.
Give them all new suits.
Like he does all the other teams.
Number 28, Mark Lewis.
You've gotten a few suits there over the years, huh?
Yeah.
You just hope the weather holds out because bad weather's moving in the New York City area. That same weather that hit Pittsburgh tonight is moving up the coast and will be in the New York City area starting tonight and into tomorrow. So they may have some troubles at Shea Stadium tomorrow.
And the weather may be bad, too.
Schedule now. That is, that game is at Atlanta, not in New York.
They play in Atlanta.
Yeah,
okay.
They play at Atlanta first, then they go to New York. So tomorrow, it's the Mets at Atlanta. Stan Belin is going to come in and try to wrap this one up.
Well, a good outing for Denny Nagel will end after eight innings. He gave up one hit, or one run, that is. Two hits overall for Denny Nagel. Three walks, six strikeouts in his eight innings. Good job by Nagel. He gives way to Stan Belin, who last pitched on Friday. A couple of innings of one-hit baseball.
Here's Mike Darr, who came in for Tony Gwynn in right field. Darr batting for Gwynn as we go to the top of the ninth. I told you about Gary Matthews Jr. and the fine young prospect he is. Darr's out of the same mold. Good rifle arm from right field and the big swing. He's in a hole, no balls and two strikes. Since coming up, 36 at bats and seven hits, so 194 average. Does have a home run and a run batted in.
Someday he'll be able to tell his grandkids he pinch hit for Tony Gwynn.
Don't you think he's already written that down? And get Tony to sign a bat if Tony has any bats left. One ball and two strikes to Darr. AAA hit 295 this year for the Padres. Off Belinda's hand. Is he all right? That's the cardinal rule, Chris. You were out there. Don't stick the bare hand out. While it sounds good, your emotion every once in a while will jump out at you and it's there. What do you do?
Sometimes you just can't coach yourself from doing it. The reaction is stop the ball with anything you can. And right here, the only thing you can get out there is his bare hand. So he sticks the meat on the ball. Fortunately, it looked like it got him flat instead of at the end of the fingers. Stan Belin are going to rub up the ball in his hand. Tell Brian Johnson he's okay and see if he can't get out of the inning lickety-split.
Brian Johnson told him, look, you know, make sure you want to throw a couple before you step in here. And he says he's okay. So John Vanderwall, the outstanding pinch hitter from the left side of the plate, will step into the batter's box. No one out and one on for Vanderwall. Vanderwall steps in at 278 with six home runs and 41 runs batted in. Stan Belinda is trying to give Denny Nagel his fifth straight victory as a starter, and it's been a while since the Reds have accomplished that. Dave Burba won his last five starts of 1997. And Nagel would join him in that category. Vanderwall passed the 100 pinch hit total for his career back in May in that select group. In fact, at the end of the year last year, they had Vanderwall and Mark Sweeney on this roster, two outstanding left-handed pinch hitters. That's one of the reasons why Sweeney ended up coming to Cincinnati. There's no room for two left-hand pinch hitters of that caliber on a roster.
Mark Sweeney found that out too when he went sent down to Indianapolis, leaving Hal Morris at the big league level. A double lesson learned by Sweeney. I think he's got it by now.
Not an easy lesson. Swing and a miss. Vanderwall's taken care of. There's your first out. Time for our Geico quote of the night. From Ted Williams, a native of San Diego, honored here in the San Diego Wall of Fame. Baseball is the only field of endeavor where a man can succeed 3 times out of 10 and be considered a good performer. And he was not a good performer, he was a great performer. So was that man who's a member of that 3,000 hit club. He became the 22nd player to reach the 3,000 hit plateau. Reds, of course, represented at the top of that list with Pete Rose.
You know, every time you see somebody hit 3,000 hits, you really start thinking about Rose, and it's like, whoa, 1,000 more. Actually, 1,500 more.
Cameron's got a chance for a double play to end the game, and he got him! How about Mike Cameron? A great catch in right center field off the bat of David Nguyen, and then the great throw to first. What an end for a great night for Cincinnati. The Reds, 12-1. Take another look at Cameron's double play throw.
Now you wonder where Dar is going on this, because Mike Cameron takes a long time. He says, hey, you're going to test my arm? I'll give it a shot. And a good stretch at the other end right there, just in the nick of time to end the ball game. That's the way this one ought to go down.
So the Reds, 12 runs, 15 hits and no errors. Cincinnati stranded 5. For the Padres, a run, 3 hits, 2 errors. And the Padres stranded 3 on the night. So the Reds win it. They take a full game off the lead of the Houston Astros. Now they're 2.5 games back of the Astros in the Central Division, and they are 3.5 games back in the wild card. So for the Reds, a good night, Chris, the way they wanted to start this final trek to San Diego.
You know, sometimes you can come in and intimidate a ball club, George, early on. The Reds gave plan for something. They've got intensity going. They needed good pitching tonight and just keep the crowd out of the ball game. They effectively did that early on.
Well, let's take a look at the highlights of this one if you joined us late. It started off with a former Red, Reggie Sanders, getting on the board early. His 25th home run of the year off Denny Nagel in the first, the 150th of his career, and San Diego had an early lead of 1-0. But the Reds started a great inning for Eddie Taubensee. In the second, Eddie hits his 20th home run. No doubt about this one, Chris, a bumper.
I'll tell you what, he had to generate a whole lot of power as that one came off the changeup.
Let's take it to the eighth inning with the Reds leading 4-1. Taubensee continues a great night. He bunts for a base hit. The throw will hit him and glance off the glove of the second baseman. The throw to the plate won't be in time, and Greg Vaughn will score. It's 5-1. Michael Tucker drills this one into the corner. It rattles around in the Reds' bullpen, and by the time they get it, Tucker has a triple two-run score, and the Reds have a 7-1 lead in an inning where this game would get out of hand. Denny Nagel helps his own cause. Finally, after 3 ground ball outs, this base hit the center makes it 8-1 Cincinnati. Sean Casey drills one through the middle of the infield to make it 9-1. Casey's second hit. He had a double and a single. The Reds lead it by a score of 9-1. The capper, Greg Vaughn, Chris, is 41st.
A 3-run bomb right here. No question about that one. He's got enough swings in this ballpark to know when he's got one out of here and when he doesn't.
And the end of it. make this double play. Cameron the catch, the throw to first. That'll wrap it up. And the Reds win it by a final score. Comfortably, as they put a ton on the board to win it by a final score of 12-1. So the Reds win it 12-1, and with it, take a half game off the wild card lead of the New York Mets, and the Mets are idle tonight, and also take a full game off the Astros because the Astros were losers in their game to the Pittsburgh Pirates at Pittsburgh. Welcome back to Jack Murphy Field at Qualcomm Stadium. George Grant along with Chris Welch and Chris. Jack McKeon said it in the pregame. He said, our job right now is to win one at a time and win every one if we have to, but just keep the pressure on the Astros, and they did it tonight.
Well, you do it, you know, you take the pressure off yourselves that way early, especially if you can score early, combine some good pitching that'll keep you into a ball game and take the crowd out of it. This is why one reason why the Reds have been so good on the road this year. They've had the ability to score early and keep the crowd out of it. And, you know, even in San Diego, where there's not a whole lot to fight for here, they still had a big crowd on hand tonight, although a lot of free people in this ballpark, it didn't matter. They gave them a good thumping, really the way they ought to make a statement every time they come out against a team like the Padres.
Hey, we started the night when the Reds came to town today. They were coming in from Pittsburgh. They come to Pittsburgh, and after a trip last night, come to the ballpark. You'd think they'd come in late, take a quick batting practice, then hit the field. This team was out early. Most of the starters were out for early batting practice, extra batting practice, and their regular batting practice. They knew the importance of this series, and they came out swinging the bats early.
Well, they've been like that all year long. They know that taking batting practice off isn't something that you do when you want to maintain the discipline. It's not that the BP is going to make you a good hitter that day, but what it does is it gets you disciplined, and I think it's very important for a team going down the stretch to know what they have to do on a regular basis, and they go out and they got to thump somebody, and I think that was very important. Overall, Greg Vaughn, a leader when it comes to that, too. He's a guy that does not let these guys back down at all.
And the sweet night of the night, Greg Vaughn had a three-run home run. He had two hits. Both of those hits came in the eighth inning. He started the rally with a base hit. His three-run home run gives him now 41 on the year after 50 here in San Diego, and you know that meant a lot to him.
Well, no question about it. You could tell early on he was trying to hit one into the upper deck the first couple of times up, and he actually had some very bad swings against the starting pitcher, Buddy Carlisle, but it came around. Greg Vaughn's a good hitter, and it's the way power hitters are. Sometimes they look bad. Sometimes they run into a pitch and drive it 400 feet.
The other side of the offensive story was Eddie Taubes. He had four hits on the night, including his 20th home run. And while you lose sometimes the effect of a game when you score 12 runs, the way Denny Nagel pitched tonight was really the key. That set the tone for the night. After the home run by Sanders, he just slammed the door.
I mean, this is what a stopper is supposed to be. I mean, after all, this Padre team is not nearly as good as the Pittsburgh Pirates team, but they're not waiting around just to be beaten. They're pretty good at home, and you've got to get out there and you make good pitches. You do that early on, you set the pace. That's what Denny did tonight right from the very get-go.
The Advance Auto Parts play of the game. Nagel walks the first two batters, but then look what happens in the fourth inning. Broken bat off Rivera, but Nagel keeps his concentration, and what a turn.
Well, he knew where this ball was going to go to. He knew he had Pokey Reese as his second baseman out there. He just fires the ball over the bag. A 1-4-3 double play. That was very big at that time in the ballgame.
Here's number 41 for Greg Vaughn.
104, 105, 6, and 7 RBI for Vaughn. Big night for him.
And Eddie Taubes, he caps it off with a four-hit night on a night where the Reds win it 12-1 over the San Diego Padres. For Chris Welch, our entire crew, this is George Grant. Good night and good morning, everybody. See you at the ballpark. Fox Sports News is next. He's learning how to call a game at the major